The next speaker is Professor Conrad Stephan, which we know as Connie, who's been a colleague and a friend for a number of years. We camped together on the ice many times, and you know, many of us glaciologists tend to have special bonds between each other because we spend time together in the same tent, and sometimes we are roped together. We may occasionally save our lives together. Connie is a professor at the University of Colorado in the Department of Geography, is the director of CIRES, which is a large research unit at the University of Colorado. He is involved with many international and national committees dealing with Arctic changes and polar regions in general. He's also responsible for maintaining a place in Greenland called Swiss Camp. Of course, Connie is born in Switzerland. Swiss Camp is always attracting a flock of scientists every year. We want to get some work done on the ice sheet. They also know that Swiss Camp has excellent coffee, excellent chocolate, and they make their own bread. In fact, the camp is so popular that it even attracts congressmen and congresswomen who want to get their own look at what the ice sheets are doing today. And when Connie lowers them occasionally in one of the moulins, they come back with a new view on changes in the ice sheets. So it's a great pleasure to have Connie come here from Boulder and talk to us about his research at Swiss Camp and other places this morning.
Thank you, Eric, for these kind words, and thank you for the invitation. When Eric started his talk, said he had a hard time following Jim Balog. What do you think what I have? I mean, Jim showed all these beautiful sceneries and the change, so I probably have to skip a third of my slides. Eric showed all the changes in the big picture. That takes another third of my slides. Isabella showed all the new results about Grace, another third of my slides, and I propose we go for lunch now. But I would like to give you an insight. I worked in Greenland for over 20 years, every year with my students, doing research on the ice sheet, taking in situ measurements or using then satellite data and models. So I will give you a very general overview about the mass balance, some introduction, why are we doing the research. Then I show you some data that we measure on the ice sheet that shows the quick changes we have in temperature or in the mass loss. And then I zoom in some of the processes that we currently observe that are responsible for some of these changes. And hopefully you get away the message that the changes are much faster than we actually can model them. Today is an exciting time to be a scientist. It's also a scary time to be a scientist because we observe every year new processes we were not aware of. And if you think how we make forecasts for sea level models, for example, these processes need to be part of the modeling. So if you are projecting for 2100, 2200 sea level, only part of our current understanding is in there. And I'm sure Kurt will give us all the insight this afternoon. Let's see if I can make the switch here. I just give you an overview of what Greenland actually, where it is. Most of you know, it is actually the biggest island on the Earth. It stretches from 82 degrees north to about 64 degrees. That's why it is relatively warm in the southern part. It covers an island with about 3 kilometers thick of ice and reaches east-west 400-500 kilometers. So it's a big piece of ice surrounded by ocean and in the north surrounded by sea ice that is retreating. That has another impact, but I don't have time to go into detail. Eric and myself haven't really discussed our slides, so that's why we use the same one. This just summarizes what we know about Greenland. I only show Greenland here, about the input and output. Eventually, we are interested how much snow is falling on the ice sheet, and what I give you is actually average over 10 years. It's in the order of 550 to 650 gigatons, and we want to know how much is lost by melt and how much is lost by the dynamic motion of the ice that breaks off the iceberg to get the balance. The balance means input-output supposed to be zero over a long time, then we have no input into the ocean. We currently observe an imbalance in Greenland, and I come back to that. in the order of 50 to 200 gigatons over that 10-year period. It has increased recently. To put it in the perspective, currently we are losing in the order of 300 gigatons of ice in Greenland. This is three times the entire ice amount we have in the European Alps. So three times the ice is lost on an annual basis in Greenland through melt and through this dynamic fast motion. I don't go in detail. I think Eric did a good job with that. What I want to get your attention is, let's look at the different volumes of ice. On the left side, you have the graph that shows glaciers 0.5. Only less than 1% ice is actually stored on all the glaciers worldwide. When you take Greenland, we have approximately 10% of the ice is in Greenland. And the big brother or sister is actually Antarctica, with close to 90% of all the ice. When we actually look at the current sea level contribution from the cryosphere, cryospheres are glaciers, ice sheets, ice caps that melt or move into the ocean. In the last IPCC report, 2007, about 70% of the sea level signal came from glaciers, to our best understanding. 20% from Greenland, about 10% from Antarctica. And only within a few years, and that's actually the result Isabella just showed, the GRACE is the new satellite that can measure the entire weight change. Just within 2-3 years, the volume has changed that glaciers still contributing a large portion. They haven't decreased, but the percentage of the glacier contribution is about 50%. Greenland has increased to 30% sea level rise contribution, and Antarctica 20, and we have heard that. So sea level has increased over a decade from about 1.3 millimeters per year to 2.2 millimeters per year just from the ice sheets. We actually have 3.3 millimeters if you look at the other contributors. What causes sea level change? It's not only the melting of ice. We all know that. It's the thermal expansion of the ocean. If the ocean gets warmer, it has a bigger volume. It is the terrestrial change of water storage on land. It is a small part, but it's getting better known now, and I think we actually had a decrease. We had stored more water on land, so we took water out of the ocean. And then it is the ocean current can actually change sea level locally. So if you have a warmer ocean current that actually has a warmer temperature in the ocean, that increases the sea level as well. Why do we care? Let's look quickly before I go into my Greenland discussion about sea level change over the last maybe 100 years or more. We have very good historical data going back to about 1850 that showed sea level change worldwide to be in the order of 1.7 millimeters per year. The more recent record here, which is the last decade, two decades, are satellite-based. That's quite accurate, and that showed an increase of approximately 3.3 millimeters. That is from the glaciers, from the thermal expansion, water storage change. And the big question is, what is the future? I'm not going into much detail, but the main point is you have a wedge. It's not just a line. There is a large uncertainty in it, but it has a huge impact. If the sea level is 50 centimeters, is it 1 meter, or is it 120 centimeters by 2100? Because that has an impact on coastlines. And I just was in Europe last week in Belgium at the EU Parliament giving a talk, and that's why I used that graph again. This is the land area you're losing by 1 meter sea level change. 1 meter is predicted by 2100 with some certainty. And it's quite a large portion of real estate going away just by looking at the red area. I can do the same. I just downloaded that for San Francisco area. This is 1 meter sea level change. All the areas in blue are the flooded areas in case the scenario 1 meter comes through by 2100. If you look currently look at where they place new buildings, new developments, it is actually in some of these areas. So if you make an investment, you better get the scientist on board to find out if you are flooded. This is a nice summary from Jim Henson. He's a researcher with NASA, and he actually summarizes the temperature change. This is the temperature for 2010 as an anomaly. We look at the time period 1951 to 1980 as a mean time period. And you can see against that time period, temperatures have increased in both polar regions in the order of 2 to 5 degrees. This is just for this 1 year. If you take the decade 2000 to 2010, it's not much different. The message is the temperature has increased several degrees in the polar regions. We know the reason why it's increasing more. We call it an albedo feedback. There's a feedback loop in there. But how does it actually affect Greenland? And that's what I want to discuss. In 1990, and Eric already alluded to it, I put up a camp called Swiss Camp. It was quite nice and proper here, 1990. And all these dots, these are stations on the ice sheet. We put 20 stations all over the ice sheet to measure the climate since 1990 to present. And around 1992-3, there was an extreme cooling. We had a Mount Pinatubo explosion that put a lot of particles very high in the atmosphere that cooled the Earth by about 1.5 degrees for 2 years. And we almost lost our station. You can see we get much more snow. We have much less melt. So it's not always a warming we have over the last 20 years. There is very strong variability. Can be affected by volcanic eruption or then the changes in ocean current or the increase in warmer water masses. 2007 is the lowest picture you can see there. I come back to that. This is the temperature record for this time period, Swiss Camp. That's one location. It's at 1,100 meters on the ice sheets. It's not close to land. It has over 1,000 meters of ice underneath. And you see a strong variability, but a strong trend too. These were the cold years where we had Mount Pinatubo. It came out. It actually was warmer than what we would predict in a scenario. And this is the measured temperature. We measure the temperature every 10 seconds. Average over a month, average over a year. These are annual measurements, but each measurement actually has 10,000s of points. And the trend is quite remarkable. Over 20 years, we have approximately 2 degrees centigrade increase per 10 years, 4 degrees over this time period. This is one of the biggest temperature increases we actually have measured on Earth. There's only such a strong temperature increase in the Antarctic Peninsula that is reasonably well defined as well by measurements. Interesting when you look at radiation. What is radiation? That is the energy from the sun that comes to the surface. Most of it is reflected because Greenland is very bright. Snow is bright, so it reflects up to 80% of energy back into the atmosphere. When I plot my net radiation, which means radiation that's coming in from space at that one location, Swiss Camp, and is reflecting out. So whatever stays can be used to melt or actually to warm the ice sheet. You can see we have an increase in energy that is coming from the sun measured at the surface of about 40 watts per square meter. This is an enormous large number. But we know the sun has been stable. It's not the sun that has changed the energy output. What actually changed is the surface. And I can show that in the next graph. When I plot the reflectivity, the albedo of that surface, which is usually 80%, 90% of the energy goes back. It's called here 0.8. This is 1993 to present for the different months. This is winter, this is the summer months. And you can see the area here during the summer is usually 0.7. That means 70% of the energy is reflected. 8, because the surface got so dark. The snow got wet. We have seen from Jim Bellock, the snow gets dark when it collects all the soot. And that is the reason why we actually are increasing the melting. We don't lose the energy, it stays locally, and that has a large effect on the melt. When I look at what we call mass balance, again, Swiss Camp, you can measure the surface. And the surface at Swiss Camp is supposed to be always at the same height relative to the summer and winter, because the snow that comes into the winter melts during the summer, and we call that the equilibrium line altitude. It has been that for about a decade. We have very accurate measurements over 20 years, and we actually see that this surface has changed in height. This is a cumulative, about 5.5 meters since 1990. I have some pictures showing some of the phases of the Swiss camp. This is the Swiss camp in this time period. We lost about 1.5 meters of ice, so our nice site collapsed. Nice, because this is the sauna, for those who know, that's a very important part. So I have a lot of grad students and some time, so we rebuilt the Swiss camp, of course, putting it not on new pillars, but enforced it, and unfortunately, that was in this time period, so it was quite stable. What happened is, during the last 2 years, the increase of melt started again, and that's how Swiss camp looked this summer. I wasn't there, actually. I left it when it was still nice. It collapsed. So that means next year I need even more grad students coming along. And we have to rebuild the station because it's one of the important parts to make these long-term measurements. We also use satellite data. A point measurement helps you to understand the process. We have satellites for 30 years and longer. We actually developed some algorithm. You can measure the melt of the entire ice sheet. This is passive microwave, centimeter wavelength. And what I plotted here is the extent of where Greenland melted in 2007. We can do that for every day of the year throughout the 30-year time period, and that gives us this variability. We understand variability because the Arctic oscillation, the ocean, the pressure changes from one year to the other, but over the time you can see the melt area, the blue, red area here, has increased continuously over that time period. This is cumulative for these years. If I sum it up, we have actually increased the melt area of the Greenland ice sheet where the snow melted about 65% since we started the measurement in 78. And that melt contributes obviously to the water runoff and to other processes. Another example, 2007 and 2010 were extreme melt years. It was about 2 to 3 degrees warmer than the long-term average. How much more melt do we actually get by just increasing the temperature? We have a lot of instruments sitting up. This is the Greenland ice sheet here, a small portion. That was the Jakobshavn and Isbrae shown by Jim Belloc, by his movies. His cameras are here. These are all our stations, Swiss camp here. We can actually calculate how much volume of melt occurred over a summer period, and you can see the number there for that area of the picture. It was 22 cubic kilometers of melt water running off. When you look at some of the ice output, it is certainly not in the same number, but it's in the same magnitude. So if you increase the melt, the temperature, you can actually lose a lot of ice just by melting, and the additional runoff was in the order of 10 cubic kilometers just for these two extreme years. Another method, we have satellite data. We have actually old aircraft data that were very accurate, so we can map the difference in where the ice sheet was in 85, where it was in 2009, and that shows you the outline. All this pinkish color is where we actually lost the Greenland ice sheet, retreated backwards, and that gives us another way to actually calculate more in detail for these different regions the ice change. I just summarized before I go into more detail. These are all the measurements known for the Greenland ice sheet mass balance. Some of them are from Eric, some of them are from Isabella and other researchers. These are the different methods. This is a time scale, 1990 to present, and on the vertical axis is the net balance change, how much ice we are losing. And if you look at the graph around in the area 1995, we were losing in the order, when we take all these measurements together, these are different methods, so we would not expect them to be exactly the same, in the order of 50 gigatons. And then, around 2000 to 2005, that loss increased to about 100 gigatons. More recently, 2005 to 2008, it was around 200 gigatons. And the latest measurements we have just heard today, they are in the order of here. I don't dare yet to put here an acceleration in it, but it is increasing continuously. And I mentioned before, 80 to 90 gigatons of ice is all the ice we have in Europe in the Alps, just to give you a relation. It is a large number. How does it relate to sea level? We have seen that before. Currently, Greenland is actually contributing about 0.8 millimeters sea level, just to put that into reference. Let's go now more in detail. You see all these blue dots. These are actually lakes. The Greenland ice sheet is not just a slab that goes towards the ocean. It is undulations. And in these undulations, you collect undulations. They are about 3 to 10 kilometers wide, like 2, 3 long, 2, 3 wide, and maybe 10, 15 meters deep. So it's not a very deep lake. All these lakes, that means the water that melts from the snow, from the ice, is collected in these. But when you actually watch from space, these lakes suddenly disappear. We started these measurements around 1995. We put some GPS instruments on the ice sheet that measured the velocity of the ice and also the vertical change very accurately, within about 2-3 millimeters. And we looked at the data, and so, well, during the summertime, interesting, the velocity actually increases slightly. And we came to a conclusion that through all these lakes that are filled with water, they're actually connecting to the underside of the ice sheet, and the water is pushed down for a short time period. It actually can reduce the friction of the underside. It's not the main cause that Greenland is losing that much mass, but it can explain 5 to 8% of it. These are the instruments we actually put up along a profile about 200 kilometers long,
increased from 100 meters to 160.
Very simple units, but when you plot
110 to about 180 meters,
the data together, and Julian Day means the day of the year, so this is the summertime period. You can see during the summer, the velocity at that one point increased from 100 meters to 160, or from 110 to about 180 meters, for about the period of 1 or 2 months, due to that water lubrication. And when we actually have more melt, that started to increase. So since we have a record from 1995 to present, we can relate quite well how much melt is needed to actually increase that ice velocity. This is a movie, if you can click somewhere in that picture. It just illustrates the mechanism. It's fun working with NASA because they have a large team to put together these nice visuals. And you can see the lake here. It starts to put water through these moulins. It pushes the water underneath the ice and then actually reduces the friction for a period of 2, 3, 4 weeks that increases the velocity of the ice along that line. Moulins, we have heard several times, and as a scientist, of course, it's not only a nice picture, but we want to know what's happening inside. And I started about 2000 working with moulins. These are my three grad students. When I told them we need to make measurements down there, nobody volunteered. So we had to come up with some kind of a mechanism, either incentive, you get your degree about 1 year earlier, or we build instruments. We decided to build instruments. Before I go there, we made a lot of measurements at the surface where the moulins are. These are actually instruments that measure the through flow of the water. These are real measurements. You have a very strong daily variability of the flow because the sun is out, you melt, the sun is gone at night, or at least a low horizon, you reduce. So you're able to actually model all the water flow on the surface, but we wanted to know how is it going into the ice, how it does it affect. What we developed here is a laser, and I show you the results in the coming. This is a rotating laser going in circ, and you can measure when you put that laser in here, and we actually eventually climbed down last year. This is a moulin about 10 meters wide, 120 meters deep, and then it continues. As we go to that site every year, we can see how it affects. So this is a movie. If you click on the center,
I can show you some of the measurements and then the results. And now you have to, yeah, good. It is on a winch, that means a winch on an electric winch goes slowly down, the instrument rotates, and a laser can measure the distance to the side of the Moulin. It's a pretty dark on this, but we actually will go in and you can see more. The reason why we did it is we realized these Moulins stay open. And we could hear from the outside a lot of water, but we didn't see the water coming in. And the important part is when you map it as a 3D, you can see all these small inlets. These are actually water channels at 10, 20, 50 meters depth coming in from the side. Because the Moulin was created at the lowest point of the ice. The ice moves. So after 1-2 years, it's no longer collecting the water as the lowest point, but the water finds its way at different depths going in. And if you do the modeling, it's quite important to actually know that if you want to know the impact. Another movie, and this shouldn't be in competition with Jim. I like his movies better, but we had some movie people coming along. It's important to show it's not that easy to send students down, because if you look from the top, it actually looks nice, but that's the problem. Water's pretty cold coming from the side. You can actually walk off or go to the side. The bigger problem is if a lake bursts a kilometer above, you will get all the water coming at once. And I never lost a grad student in the field, so we are quite careful with these measurements. And the person you actually seen in this movie, that was a Japanese cameraman, wasn't one of my students. That just shows you the schematic, how the Discovery Channel put it all together. It's actually not accurate, but it gives you the perception that the water is pushed in. Actually, the ice sheet can lift up, as we have seen, because of the water pressure. Water is heavier than ice. You can lift up the ice slightly and then move it more in front. Is it real or is it just perception when we look at these channels coming from the side? We use a lot of radar measurements as well. What you see here, these very strong reflectors, this is the depth, zero, that's 100 meters. These are Moulins at certain depths and they connect up here. What you can see here in these lines, this is actually, I put some color in here. These are these channels, these water channels that connect as channels in these Moulins. And that became quite important when we want to model how does water affect the ice sheet, how does it affect the internal temperature, and what is the impact when we have increase in melt. We need to know the length of these channels. They stay open. This was actually in spring, in May. In May, we don't have any water. So according to our previous information, channels are supposed to close just by the viscosity of ice. That was not the case. A lot of these channels actually remain open, and they even keep some water in there. Otherwise, you would not even have a reflector in the radar signal. I only show one modeling result because we started to use our data to look at the present and at the future, and when we put some warming effect in the model, this is a two-dimensional ice sheet model. That's the distance from summit, from the highest point of the ice sheet, so the last 100 kilometers of the ice sheet, and this is the temperature change. If we increase, according to the IPCC scenario, what is the temperature increase over the next 50 years, we only use 50 years, how would it affect the temperature within the ice sheet? And because of these water channels going through and the Moulins, we actually change the temperature up to 8 degrees centigrade, and that is about 600 meters to 1,000 meter thickness here in that part. You could say, okay, what's the point? But if the ice is 8 degrees warmer, it is actually no longer as stiff. That means it will flow faster towards the coast. And if we increase the entire temperature of the ice along the whole perimeter, we have another mechanism that actually increases the ice loss just because the ice gets more viscosity. My final slide For me, this is Mother Earth here.
You can read them, but it's on a slant, not because it's leaking, it's still doing fine.
As a scientist, it's exciting to see there are people pushing and people pulling here.
And somehow new processes, we have heard on several topics today.
It's also scary because a lot of these changes occur much faster. Communicate the science we do to the public, to the policymaker. I was lucky to take quite a large number of policymakers to the field, but still, I'm not so sure who is pulling and who is pushing on this bigger problem. I think it is important we communicate our results in a way to the policy, to the public, to show the changes is faster than we actually expected. There is a large uncertainty by projecting to 2100 if you look at the ice change. But as scientists, we are used to work with uncertainty. Uncertainty will decrease if you know more about the processes. And if you make a very simple comparison, I'm not the finance person. Uncertainty on any stock market, I talked with some investors, is currently much larger than any uncertainty what we have in our climate change. Thank you very much.
There was a lot of discussion today about the actual ice melt, but what about the heat transfer back into the ocean currents themselves of dumping that much ice into what has been a warmed current and then chilling it off in terms of what happens to the strength of the current and also what's going to happen as the current moves down the coastlines and impacts the overall ocean temperature along those where those exit currents are located.
If you compare the ice melt in Greenland, for example, and all the freshwater flux coming from precipitation into the ocean, there is 10 times more precipitation from the area around the Arctic Ocean than is coming just from the Greenland ice sheet additional melt. So it is a small portion. And the variability of precipitation from one year to the next can be 50%. So if you think that a change in meltwater from Greenland can change the ocean temperature, that is a very, very, very small signal. It does not even change salinity significantly. There were several models for this halothermal circulation, and it takes 50 years is about 10 times more freshwater flux than we have today in Greenland to make a small change, which actually would cool the climate, wouldn't warm.
What governments are in the forefront of this research and getting the message out? And is there one international body that you feel is being the forerunner in educating the world?
I don't know that there is one international body. There are a lot of organizations that have an interest in telling these stories. I mean, every scientist in the world who's funded, for starters, has an interest in telling the story. Al Gore's group, Alliance for Climate Protection, National Geographic, I'm talking the United States here, National Resources Defense Council, NRDC, Nature Conservancy, Sierra Club, lots of people are trying to tell the story as best they can. But there's a lot of stories in the changing environment that draw a lot of interest, a lot of attention, a lot of media airtime. So it's a complicated problem. But I think from a communication standpoint, the biggest difficulty is that the journalism system has grown up, rightly so, with a model where you report one side and then you report the other side. And it gives equal weight to idiotic information and good information. So, and that's known in the journalistic circles. It's understood that there's a real problem with this, well, he said this and she said that when it comes to reporting climate change. And there's now much more of a movement towards trying to filter some of the noise, that the journalists who are reporting this stuff are much more skeptical, particularly about the negative side. But that said, Wall Street Journal and Fox have a very strong vested interest in terms of their circulation, their readership, and ultimately their funding base, in being the ones who are always being the skeptical naysayers. And so there's this ever-increasing cultural battle from these other sides. And it's turning out to be almost as bad as the Democrats and Republicans. And I don't know how there's going to be enough of a strong voice to counteract the malicious and negative and deceiving propaganda that's out there. Because the guys spreading the deceiving propaganda have a gigantic financial interest in spreading that, whereas those of us on our side do not have major lobbying campaigns well-funded to put out the accurate message. It's a really difficult and uphill fight. Did I say anything useful?
I will give just two small remarks. I was last week in Brussels, and it was Prince Albert II from Monaco has a big foundation he sponsors now, which is the Changing Arctic. And he was able to invite the President of Iceland, two prime ministers, State Department, Statoil, the biggest oil company, researchers, and indigenous people. And for 2.5 days, we were just discussing what's the best sustainable way to develop the Arctic in a warming climate. If you go over to Washington, currently, if you mention the name climate on the Hill, it's a no-no word. And I was told by insiders at the Hill, don't send us any more scientists. That's the perception right now we have in the US when you look into the climate change. Whereas in Europe, we had the meeting at the EU Parliament, we had the parliamentarians participating. They are fully engaged because there's a big economic interest in the Arctic, in a warming Arctic. Not just because of the oil, it's a big fishery. We actually need in new laws because it's a freebie for all, the deep Arctic, that ice is disappearing. There is no regulation about fishing. And we know that people want more fish, so that's why they collaborate on that basis. The climate part in the US, we don't have a climate service. We were hoping to get a climate service through NOAA that actually can look in the seasonal to decadal changes. It became a no-no right now. We can't use the word. We have to talk about climate variability.
I want to thank our speakers, and especially our guest speakers who came this morning from Colorado to share their experience and their work with us.